everyone. So my name's Sasha. I'm currently the junior analyst at Ingentium. So in our main newsletter, we asked our newsletter subscribers as well as our clients to send us any relevant questions they may have. And a common question we had was about the Nagoya protocol and how it affects researchers as well as IP management activities. So I've made this short vlog explaining what the Nagoya protocol is, and I hope you find it useful. There's also a written version of this blog available on our website, which you can check out. So first things first, what is the Nagoya protocol? The Nagoya Protocol is a supplementary agreement to the Convention on Biological Diversity. The convention was set up to recognize the importance of biological resources, and it was adopted in 1993 and has three main objectives: the conservation of biological resources, sustainable use of its components, as well as the fair and equitable sharing of the benefits that come from using the components. The main issue with the convention was that it lacked legal certainty, and the common concern of biopiracy meant that the third objective was not being met, which is the fair and equitable sharing of benefits that come from using genetic resources. So, what is biopiracy? Biopiracy is the unlawful or unethical appropriation of biological resources without providing any financial compensation to the country they were taken from. So a classic example of biopiracy is the case of the neem tree in India, where the neem tree provided many uses for local communities, one of the uses being as a fungicide. In the early 90s, a US firm patented a fungicide with neem origins without providing any benefits to the local communities or the Indian government, thereby failing to meet the third objective of the convention. So in 2010, a treaty was signed in Nagoya, Japan, the Nagoya Protocol, which created a legal framework for the third objective, the fair and equitable sharing of benefits that come from using genetic resources. So what does the Nagoya Protocol do? Well, as I've mentioned, it creates a legal framework for the third objective by creating conditions for accessing genetic resources and traditional knowledge on genetic resources. And genetic resources are just non-human genetic resources such as plants, animals, and microorganisms. And traditional knowledge is a bit trickier to explain, so we'll describe it as knowledge or practices that have been carried out by local communities for generations. And what the Nagoya Protocol requires from users is to obtain prior informed consent before accessing genetic resources. And prior informed consent is consent given by the provider country based on sufficient information about the research project. Users are also required to establish mutually agreed terms, which is a contractual agreement that sets out what genetic resources are going to be accessed, as well as what benefits are going to be shared between the users and providers. So in the UK, we're governed by an EU regulation that sets out the compliance measures for the Nagoya Protocol and requires users to exercise due diligence to ensure that they follow the access and benefit sharing measures that each country have in place. So a useful tool in exercising due diligence is by using the Access and Benefit Sharing Clearinghouse, or the ABSCH, which is a database that contains information and documents on accessing genetic resources. It also contains contact information for the National Focal Point, which is the relevant authority to contact if you seek information on obtaining prior informed consent or establishing mutually agreed terms. One thing to bear in mind with the ABSCH is that the information on there varies from country to country, and some countries may have more useful information than others. Under the EU regulation, users are required to make declarations of due diligence at two stages of the research project. Firstly, before the research project commences, after funding has been received, and secondly, at the final development stage of the product made using the genetic resource. Declarations can be made using the Declare Nagoya IT system, and they are done electronically. Provider countries will then issue out permits granting access to their genetic resources, and the information from these permits will then be uploaded onto the ABSCH, where they become internationally recognized certificates of compliance and act as evidence to show that the user has followed that country's access and benefit sharing measures. Certificates of compliance also fit in with the objective behind the Nagoya Protocol of creating more legal certainty and transparency between users and providers of genetic resources. So what if you're in a country that isn't party to the Nagoya Protocol, like the US or Ireland? Well, considering there are so many other countries that are party to the Nagoya Protocol, particularly those with rich biodiversity, it may not be relevant that your home country isn't party to the Nagoya Protocol, as you may still need to follow the access and benefit sharing measures that that provider country have in place. So let's say a US researcher wanted to access a bacterial strain that was unique to India. There is still a legal requirement for them to follow the access and benefit sharing measures that the Indian government have placed on users of genetic resources that originate from India. In such instances, the ABSCH would be a useful tool in understanding the relevant legal requirements that the researcher must meet. So there's certainly mixed reviews about the Nagoya Protocol, but most people recognize that it's an important measure to have in place. Some people feel, though, that the Nagoya Protocol is too harsh on users of genetic resources. The Chartered Institute for Patent Attorneys, for example, feel that following Brexit, the UK should release the grip that the Nagoya Protocol places on UK researchers. There are also those that argue that the Nagoya Protocol does not do enough to protect holders of traditional knowledge, and that a better solution may be the traditional knowledge digital library, like the one in India, to prevent commercial exploitation of traditional knowledge. In a recent conference, there have been discussions to include digital sequence information, or DSI, in the scope of the Nagoya Protocol. DSI refers to genetic sequence data obtained from a resource such as a plant or a bacterium. What this means is that users planning on accessing DSI would need to obtain permission from the relevant provider country. Interestingly, countries with rich biodiversity, such as South Africa, have argued that the focus should be held on the fair and equitable sharing of benefits, whether physical or digital. But many feel that there are virtually zero benefits that come from accessing DSI and so should not be included in the scope of the Nagoya Protocol. Overall, a general critique of the Nagoya Protocol is that it's quite ambiguous and lacks clarity, which is a contradiction to its main objective of providing legal certainty for users and providers of genetic resources. So what does this mean for our viewers? Well, if you're planning on accessing genetic resources from a country that's party to the Nagoya Protocol, you would need to go onto the ABSCH and determine what the access and benefit sharing measures are for that relevant provider country. This may involve obtaining prior informed consent and establishing mutually agreed terms. If you're based in the EU or the UK, you would need to make the two necessary declarations of due diligence using the Declare IT system. So a few things to bear in mind is that some countries have clear-cut access and benefit sharing measures in place, while others do not, and so we would recommend starting the process significantly before your research project. The transparency element of the Nagoya Protocol also means that your information will be publicly available, and so if you would prefer to remain anonymous, you would need to take the necessary steps to ensure that your name and the genetic resources that you're going to access remain confidential. And the last thing to remember is that if you're in a country that isn't party to the Nagoya Protocol, you may still need to follow the access and benefit sharing measures that the relevant provider country have in place. So I hope you found this blog useful, and if you have any questions, just drop us an email at info@ingentium.co.uk, and also be sure to subscribe to our newsletter and just keep the questions coming and it may be featured in our next blog. Thanks for watching. This is Sarsha. Till next time. Bye.